Welcome, my friends, to another YouTube version of the BJJ Brick podcast. I hope you enjoy the show, and if you do, please subscribe to the channel. So here we go.
Thank you for listening to the BJJ Brick podcast. We'll be bringing you Brazilian jiu-jitsu and good times. We hope to flatten your jiu-jitsu learning curve, help you get the most out of your grappling ability, and meet your goals both on and off the mat.
Welcome back, my friends, to episode 173 of the BJJ Brick podcast. I'm Gary. I'm here with my co-host, Byron. How are you doing today, Byron?
Gary, I'm doing great. We're finally happy to have the BJJ Brick podcast coach of the year, Larry Keith, on the show. So happy to present him to the audience, as we do on the podcast world in audio.
You know, the cool thing is we've now been in this for, 3 years, and this was our first year having it. So Larry is the very first BJJ Brick Coach of the Year, and we're going to have one each and every year. I think it's really cool. So everybody who submitted this year and your coach didn't win, but you've got a great coach, definitely get in at it next year again, send him back, and we'll do it again. But I just can't wait to talk to Larry, you know, the BJJ Brick Coach of the Year.
There we go. So that's coming up very soon. But for now, I want to tell you guys about our audiobook we have for sale. It's Your First Year of BJJ, where I will walk you through or over the hurdles you might encounter that first year of grappling. May it be finding a school, figuring out the good techniques, or just the social aspect of jiu-jitsu. There's a lot you could encounter right away, and that can kind of set you back or hold you back that first year. You might get through your first year just fine, but you maybe could be a little bit further ahead by the end of that year if you avoid certain aspects of it as well. So that's kind of the goal with the book. The audio book is to kind of get you grappling, keep you grappling, help you get the most out of your grappling ability, and have a good time while doing it. And the book is $11.99. The money goes to help support the podcast and the website, bjjbrick.com. And sales have been good, and we're appreciating everybody who goes and checks out the audiobook. Let us know how you like it if you do get the book.
Yeah, definitely check it out. Like Byron said, sales have been through the roof. Very good reviews, and definitely help you through your first year. So check out the link on the show notes. Definitely make sure you check out our show notes for our email list. Definitely get on our email list. All we need is a valid email address, and that way you'll get the show delivered directly to your email, to your inbox each and every week. That way you'll never miss a show. Very easy, crisp and clean, no caffeine. You'll never miss a show. So check out our email list.
Crisp and clean like Gary is every time. We'll have, like on this example, we'll have Larry Keith, his school will have a link, and you can go to the website and check that out. Or you can go to your inbox and you could see you know, that link there. So it's all easy, and if for some reason you forget the podcast comes out, you get a little email reminding you, hey, check it out. Here's what's happening this week on the show. This is a little way to stay in touch with you guys. It's pretty simple.
Yeah, I think we're up to double digits now, so we're rolling.
Yes, indeed we are. Triple yep. digits, actually, Gary.
Triple, awesome. That's better than double.
Yeah. Speaking of triple digits, we've got the man for the quote here, Gary, a triple digit man himself.
Thomas, are you saying Jefferson. He only has three fingers?
I don't know what I was implying by that, but we'll go with that.
Okay. Well, he's probably good at bowling.
There we go. Gary, I think you have the quote here. What is the quote, my friend?
The quote is, "Nothing can stop the man with the right mental attitude from achieving his goal. Nothing on earth can help the man with a wrong mental attitude." And that was by our friend Thomas Jefferson, four-stripe brown belt. A positive attitude is the key to life. You know, I say that all the time when somebody new comes into work in my department. The very first thing I say is, you know, the only two things you need to do to achieve success here is show up for work every day, which seems kind of hard for some people, and have a positive attitude. And a positive attitude is basically going to affect you. It's going to affect your teammates, everybody you roll with, to get better. And only you can really bring yourself down. You're going to run into a bunch of obstacles that can be negative. It's up to you to turn that negative into a positive. Does it really bother you that much? I mean, we're in control of our own attitude. If we're positive, we hang out with positive people, we talk about positive things, good things are going to happen. As soon as we let these obstacles get to us, we start, you know, complaining. It's everybody's fault, this and that. I don't have as much money as this guy. My Kimura is not as good as Byron's, you know, so on, so on. Man, it just leads you down a bad path. It's going to take you where you don't want to go. We have to have a positive mental attitude to succeed in life.
Yeah, all that is great, Gary. But I got to say, if your Kimura is not as good as mine, you have the right to be kind of grumpy, because my Kimura is pretty bad. But yeah, it is how you look at it. You know, we are all dealt different cards in life, but you just have to play the hands you have and to have a good attitude about that. Look at somebody who on some respects would be having a terrible day. Somebody who was in a car accident. Their car has been totaled. And, you know, that would ruin a lot of people's days, weeks, months, whatever. It's a lot of money, a big headache, and hopefully, you know, that's about it. But
yeah, think of the guy with the quote, like Byron said, you know, the man with triple digits, Thomas Jefferson. And sounds like from what Byron said, he didn't have all his fingers. He's probably had three of them, according to what Byron said. Byron said he had three fingers, and he could have really, you know, went downhill from there. But no, he became president. Look at the guy. That's just impressive.
I was really meaning his ability to score in basketball. He'd always get in the triple digits.
Oh, he scored over 100 points a game? Oh, yeah. I thought only Will Chamberlain and Lisa Leslie did that.
And you're forgetting the Thomas Jefferson?
I think you're saying he had a triple-double.
He shot a lot of three-pointers.
Okay, that works.
Okay, but what I'm saying is, if you wreck your car today, you know, hopefully you don't, but that's bad. That sucks. But having the great attitude of, I didn't even get hurt, or if I got hurt, you know, say you lost your leg in a car accident, I'm not dead. You know, those are things that are way more important than the condition of your vehicle. And so just having that spin, you could go through your whole month being upset about your car. You lost your great car. You're going to have to get one that's not as nice. Or you can go through the whole week like ecstatic that you actually lived through this accident that could have killed you. And that, you know, you're lucky to, you're fortunate enough to be alive still. And just the comparison of those two different people who are in the same situation, take that example, you know, it's kind of an extreme example, but through the rest of their life, you know, let's say you get fired today. That could be like the worst day, and it will probably be a rough day, but it could also lead to a great opportunity within, you know, a month or 6 months down the road. You're onto something that is way more exciting and interesting to you than you could have imagined if you were still stuck in the current place you are. So it's just that attitude of taking things, making some adjustment to it, and you know, going forward. And we see that in jiu-jitsu a lot too. You might get you know, kind of beat up by your teammates today, and you could be upset about that and discouraged, but really you need to be grateful that you have a teammate and you have a team that can do that to you and for you. And there, that's your biggest asset, is having quality training partners. And yeah, so it's all over the place. Having a great attitude makes all the difference. And I know for myself and Gary, we like to train with people who have great attitudes. So that's why we're always inviting the listeners to get on the mats with us, because you guys have been great so far.
Yep. Speaking of, I've kind of got an example that just happened before we went on the show. You know, we're talking about having the right mental attitude, and I was talking about, besides having the right mental attitude, hang out with people with a good mental attitude. You know, it's going to make your attitude a little bit better. If I hang out with a bunch of people who are downers, I'm going to be down. If I hang out with a bunch of positive people, there's a better chance I'm going to be positive. But we were talking about, before we got on the show, I've got a hamstring injury, hurt my hamstring on Thursday night playing basketball. And, you know, the morning before that, I broke my toe. So I've just had some kind of injuries, and tried to get on the mat this morning with a messed up hamstring and hurt it again. And, you know, to be honest, I was a little down. I've been sitting there thinking, and I consider myself a positive person, but I'm like, oh boy, I might have to take some time off, you know, this and that. And, you know, so I was telling that to Byron. And the first thing Byron, I mean, he didn't say, oh, sorry, which, I mean, that's nothing wrong with saying sorry. It's, you know, he's just trying to be nice. But Byron didn't say that. And, you know, I kind of appreciate it because that kind of just makes me feel like I'm a charity case. But, you know, Byron, you kind of made me feel a lot better about the situation. I told Byron I may take some time off. And may is the key word because if you know me, I'll find a way to get on the mats, no ifs, ands, or buts. But Byron's like, you know, even if you take a time off, your game's probably going to explode. You're going to still show up and you're going to watch people and train some people and talk to people and have fun, you know, be a positive influence. But your body's going to rest. You're still going to be around jiu-jitsu. And when you come back, you're going to be so excited to come back. You're going to be healed. Everything's going to be feeling great. You're probably just going to, you know, explode. And just that little talk that lasted maybe 1 minute made me feel a lot better about if I do take time off or about my injury. And really, it's an injury. Big deal. I'll come back from it. I can't let that get me down. You know, it was getting me down in the short run. But, you know, talking to Byron, having friends and teammates that are positive influence got me back, you know, got my head back above water. You know, I was starting to sink a little bit. I was down. So that's just a testament to have good, positive people in your corner. When you do feel like you're in a dark spot, which I have no reason to be down. And sometimes you just need a little help from a friend. I don't know who sang that, but it might have been like the Rolling Stones or somebody. But sometimes you do need a little help from a friend just to keep you from drowning. And that's what you did there, Byron. So thank you for being a positive influence on me.
Yeah, Gary, I got to be honest. I was getting a little nervous when you were to say what I said because I don't remember it. But yeah, you always bounce back from injuries, but you rarely actually take time off. I do think that if you did take a week or even two off, your mind stays in jiu-jitsu, but your body kind of exits for that time, and you can come back and get some pretty good gains. You know, you haven't taken that much time off pretty much ever, so it's not like it's a regular thing for you, but your mind will keep working on problems and try to figure things out, and if you just stick around, you know, being around jiu-jitsu, it shouldn't be a big deal for your overall game.
Yep, and once again, like I said, thank you for the good advice.
Okay, we better transition, my friend.
Yep. Don't forget to tune in next week as Dr. Byron will solve our problems for us.
Catch me outside, Gary. Well,
Byron,
Gary,
do you want me to pay my copay in cash, or can I use my debit card?
You could just be a Patreon supporter of the podcast. No, we're all good, Gary.
Yeah, I'll go on to Patreon.
There you go. I guess it's time, Gary, to transition to the typical article of the week, but this time we're changing it up yet again. We do like to do articles, but we're trying this new thing every now and then. We've done one or maybe two before. Gary, I was driving home from work, and it's early in the morning. I work a 24-hour shift, so I get to work in the morning, and then I leave in the next morning. But driving home from work, it's kind of the traffic time of day, about 7:30 or so. And I'm on the highway, and it's backed up for about 3 or 4 miles. And I can't really tell for sure how far it's backed up, but we stop, and I'm looking, and man, every time there's a hill, I can see pretty far. There's just cars sitting there. I'm like, this is not really what I wanted to do this morning, is to sit for an hour in traffic. So I made an adjustment, exited the highway as soon as I could, and took the side roads home, and made it home just fine. Of course, a little bit later than usual, but I was able to get home. And I probably could have still got home taking the normal way, the highway, the traffic jam, and been a part of that. But it would have been slower. It would have been more frustrating and more annoying. And I'm doing this. I'm basically taking a detour, and I'm thinking about it's the same thing in jiu-jitsu all the time. You're constantly being fed little roadblocks to us, a little traffic jam or a roadblock, or for some reason a bridge is out. You might be trying to pass my guard to the right, trying it, and suddenly you look over and there's an opportunity to the left. And if you really wanted to pass to the right, your main goal probably is just to pass. And so to kind of take that detour and pass the other way is something you could do. Or perhaps, you know, you're training for a tournament. You're a few weeks out from that tournament and you injure, you pull a hammy or you break your little toe or something like that. Can you still compete? Well, you need to make that call, and only really you know that or your doctor. But like, let's say a broken toe, you might have to make some adjustments to your game. You might not be able to play such a great, I don't know, spider guard or something like that where you might be using your toe. You might not be able to even, you know, do your stand-up portion of the game that you've been planning, working your takedown. You might have to start pulling guard or maybe do a fake guard pull or something to get the match started the way you want it. But you're going to be fed some detours either by choice or by force. You know, sometimes you go, I'll take the long way home, I'll go by the store today and pick something up. Or you might, there's a big old roadblock up ahead of you and you have to change the way you were going, but you still want to get to that goal that you had. You want to get home. You want to do well in that tournament. You want to pass the guard and get to a dominant position. All these are things that kind of I was thinking about as I was, you know, stuck in traffic thinking about, yeah, I should probably get off the highway. I'm not really going anywhere right now. So I think that's just a way to look at something while you're rolling. Am I hitting a roadblock? And how could I go around that? And Gary, do you see this much in jiu-jitsu?
Well, first of all, I do want to say I thought I was the only person who did that. This sounds kind of weird, but I try to take a different way to work each and every day. And it might only just be one street, you know, for a mile, but it's kind of weird. People laugh at me that every day I just try to go a different way. I try not to just do the same thing. And I don't really know why I do that. I guess because I don't have a time. I have to be at work. I can show up whenever. So it may take me a little bit longer, but that way I just don't see the same thing every day. I go down roads that I never have went down. And when I tell people about this, they all laugh at me. And I had no clue you were going down this path. And I don't think I've ever told you that I do that. So I just thought that was kind of funny just because everybody calls me the weirdo for doing that. But going back to it, I do see like what you're talking about in jiu-jitsu is a lot of times you were talking about that guard pass. You know, you want to pass left or pass right. A lot of times I think sometimes we're too narrow-minded, our eyesight's too focused on one thing and doing it one way only. And we just try to push down that wall that's in front of us. You know, we want to pass, you know, left. We never even think about passing right. And we just keep pushing and pushing and pushing and, you know, getting tireder and tireder and tireder. And you know, pretty soon we just drop because we're so exhausted. And we do need to look at, you know, other streets. I mean, we don't want to just go down that dead end street and just get stuck and can't turn around, can't back up because now all of a sudden a bunch of cars are behind you. You do have to, you know, open your vision. You know, the peripherals, as we call it, you know, look out of the corner of your eyes. There's another path. Like you said, we're all trying to get to the same spot, which is either, you know, we're trying to pass that guard, or if you're coming home from work, you're trying to get home. And, you know, there's more than one path to get there. And sometimes I think we just go down that same old path each and every time. And you're going to get good at going down that same old path, but each person is going to have a different obstacle for that path. If, you know, I may not be a very good guard player and Byron can pass my guard like it's Swiss cheese and keeps going to the same way. But then next thing you know, he gets Keenan Cornelius and, you know, he's trying to do the exact same thing he does to me and he ends up in trouble. It's he's going to have to try to take a different path that, you know, Main Street's not working. He should have turned left on First Street. And so I do think that's a good analogy. I never really thought about how, you know, driving to work and driving down roads translates to jiu-jitsu. But that's a very good analogy.
Part of the thing, and I didn't realize that you take different ways to get to work, but that is interesting, Gary. I think that's part of your witness protection program that we're not supposed to talk about on the podcast. people are after you, Gary, so that's very scary.
Yeah, well, that's why I started jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
Because of the people that were after me.
It's all coming together, my friend.
Yeah, but the bad thing is, when I started, I didn't realize jiu-jitsu didn't work on ghosts. So I am a little frustrated with that.
Okay, you got to find the right path to choke out that ghost, Gary. And you're trying human techniques. You got to.
I'll get
it.
There. Yeah, I'll get there someday.
Yep. More, the biggest disguise is to put some holy water in your drink and then sneak that on the mat. But anyway, another thing about the detour.
We just took a detour.
Yes, we have taken a few. is that it helped. When I got off the highway, I knew where I was. This wasn't the first time that I have navigated this part of the city on these roads.
Oh, Byron.
I didn't have to pull up a map, Gary, to get and get home. I've been there before, so same thing when you're passing the guard.
Yeah, well, I did get a message from your wife that said you did try to take that other way home, and you ended up lost. When you got out of your car to ask for directions, you got beat up, your car stolen, and they found it 3 weeks later. Was that true, or was she just making that up?
They found it 3 days later, Gary.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I mean, she might have exaggerated that part slightly. But, but it does help that I'm familiar with where I'm going anyway. So, same thing, if you only pass to the left every time, that detour is going to be confusing for you. You're not going to be able to take it. You're not going to be able to pass to the right. And when you do get to the right, you'll be on the wrong side of side control for you as well. And you'll be a little bit mixed up, and you might have to circle all the way around the top. You go north-south and get to the side, or maybe cross over to mountain and get back to the side if you want. If that's where you ultimately wanted to be, I don't know. But if you occasionally drive around the city, not on the highways, if you occasionally explore outside of your specific game, not all the time, but you're familiar with it, it's a lot easier, Gary. It makes it to where you know what's coming up at the next intersection. You know how many miles you're going to go, and then you're going to take a certain, you know, left or right up at this street, and you're going to zig around the town a little bit, but you're going to make it. If I'm in a hurry, this route's better. If I'm, you know, not that big a deal, maybe the sun's in my eyes, I'll take this street that's going diagonal. There's a lot of stuff going on there, Garrett. I think I just confused myself. So,
no, but it is a good point. Like, you start going down different roads that you normally don't go down, your game's going to get better and more efficient. Hence, your gas mileage is going to be better too. So, I think that makes a lot of sense. Wouldn't you agree, Byron?
Well, they say your gas mileage is better on the highway. So, think about that, Gary. You're more efficient sticking to the place that you know the best. You don't have to use as much energy. If you're able to pull off that first guard pass that you always like to do, if that works first time, good efficiency, good gas mileage. Yeah. But if you're having to get off the road, you'll burn up a little bit more gas, but you'll still get there.
Yeah, less emissions. So, I mean, less emissions will be less chance of climate change.
You're saying submissions or emissions?
Emissions. But sometimes if you got a tight submission on somebody, that guy's going to emission something. It has happened, my friends. Not to me.
All right. Gary, we have taken this little story all over
the
place.
And made a detour. Yes.
Made detours. And so usually this time of the podcast was filled with a article of the week. Told a little story. We talked about it. We broke it down into a little jiu-jitsu style. Let us know if you like this. We've done a couple of them. We've got a little bit of feedback, but not a ton. And next week we'll have an article as usual. And we'll probably consider doing another story or two like this again in the near future, but not right away. But it's kind of fun to kind of throw out something like that and play with it and see where it takes us, Gary. Like a cat and a ball of yarn.
Yep, I'm the ball of yarn and you're the cat.
So many odd things I could say back to you at that one, Gary, but I'll leave it at that. Gary, I'm excited for the interview.
Let's get on to interviewing Larry Keith.
He is the most interesting grappler in the world.
In the 80s, he started every match with a flying armbar. One day, he was running late for an open mat, his car wouldn't start, and he was able to start it too with a flying armbar. With a gentle sweeping motion, he can rock any crying baby to sleep.
I don't always listen to podcasts, but when I do, I prefer the BJJ Brick podcast. Stay sweaty, my friends.
All right, my friends. I'm happy to bring Larry Keith to the BJJ Brick podcast. Larry, welcome to the show. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Your name sounds familiar to a lot of our audience because you are the BjjBrick Coach of the Year. One of your students wrote in an essay kind of describing how you affected his life off the mat. You really helped pick him up in a time that was very difficult for him and his family. And I think it was a very touching essay, one that really got at a lot of us. And the work you did, the bonds that you made with your student was something that we definitely wanted to recognize. And I think that talking to you a little bit before we got recording here, it just sounds like you're a great person to have as a jiu-jitsu coach on and off the mat. So, Larry, welcome to the BjjBrick podcast.
Thank you.
Larry, we can't obviously wrap you up in a essay and learn everything about you there. Could you maybe describe yourself? Tell us a little bit about who you are, where you're training, and a little bit about yourself.
Well, I'm happily married with two children. I have a 9-year-old boy and a 5-year-old daughter, and both of them also train jiu-jitsu and judo. And I've been practicing martial arts for roughly 35 years, somewhere around there. I started in striking arts when I was a kid, like, you know, so many other of us. Kept doing that for quite a while. And then actually got involved with Umpqua Community College here locally, a local college, and needed a PE credit. They offered Kodokan Judo as a PE credit. And I thought, well, that's an easy thing for me because I've already been practicing martial arts. And so I got involved in the class there and discovered that there was a diamond in the rough. There was that the instructor there was from Japan and from the Kodokan Judo, you know, world headquarters. And lucky enough, just happened to live here locally and was teaching judo there. And I started there about 1990 and trained there until they closed down the program eventually in 2002. I was a assistant instructor from 1997 until, excuse me, until 2002. And 2002 is when we opened up our dojo, so which is Dynamic Martial Arts, and we're located in Roseburg, Oregon. Roseburg's a town of about less than 25,000 people. And so we've been operating for going on 15 years now.
Wow, Larry, that's a long time to be running a martial arts school. What was your original desire to open up your own place?
Well, it's funny. My original desire was based on two things, really. My sensei was moving away, and so that's part of why the program at the college was closing down. And he requested, he said, you know, I know you like this stuff and you should find a way to keep teaching it. And so that was one factor. The other factor was I really opened up originally for sparring partners, as people to have people to roll with, to do judo and jiu-jitsu with. And, you know, and then it grew, you know, and you're teaching people and they're paying you money to provide a quality class for them. And so, you know, the responsibility became greater. And so I started, you know, my focus changed on, hey, this is helping other people. And I need to, you know, I need to change my focus on that and help them, and be a little more selfless about the situation. And it just, I think that attitude, was something people picked up on and helped it continue to grow. So we started off with about, I think a half dozen students that we had carried over from the college program. And now we have roughly about between 150 and 170 students right now. Most of them are kids.
Wow, that is a lot of people and sounds like a lot of kids training there. How about yourself personally? Could you tell me a little bit about your development as a martial artist, maybe the style of jiu-jitsu that you like to play, what you do on the mat?
Well, I'm a big guy. You know, in the judo, I have, a black belt, a third degree black belt in Kodokan judo. And then, currently a brown belt in Brazilian jiu-jitsu. We're an affiliate of Impact Jiu-Jitsu out of Portland and, with Michael Chapman as my head coach. And because I'm big, I like to play pressure, of course. I like to include the throws and the takedowns, and I've really focused over the years on incorporating tying the throws and takedowns into going right into dominant positions on the mat rather than what I call throwing an opponent away. I don't want to just throw them and then have to chase after them. I like to throw and have good control so that you can do a good follow-up attack, a good guard pass, or a good position, land in some kind of dominant position. Pressure passing. I'm a big fan of pressure passing, big fan of the pressure game overall. But I've also focused on trying to be as smooth as possible, because of this, being a bigger guy. I try to avoid the, what do you call it? I've had smaller guys, over the years, they'll say, well, you only got away with that because you're big. And I'm like, okay, well, maybe if your jiu-jitsu was a little better, it would have worked, So I focused on trying to be smooth and try not to use, or be strength dependent. I don't think there's anything wrong with being strong or using the strength, but it needs to be applied in the right direction and in the right manner.
How would you describe that scenario of it's okay to be strong and to even use that strength, but to really not abuse it? How would you coach a newer person who is a big, strong person? They want to do well, but they're really overlooking the technique. How would you kind of coach them back to the technique portion of jiu-jitsu?
Well, one of the things that I'll discuss at the end of a class sometimes when we have a group of new students, a couple of new guys or whatever, maybe some white belts that have been with us for a little while. At the end of the night, after we've gotten in some grappling rounds, I like to point out, look around you and look who's breathing really hard and look who's not. You're going to see the advanced guys a little bit more cool and collective, and you're going to see the newer people huffing and puffing quite a bit. And I explain that that's because these guys, the advanced guys, have jiu-jitsu tools, and they're using those tools. And right now, as a beginner, you don't have those tools, so you're using the tools you have, which is your strength and other things that you've depended on. And those things will work for a while, but then you're going to exhaust those. And when you're exhausted and tired is when jiu-jitsu really starts to happen. And that's why these guys that are in the upper ranks are able to wear you down and then, work their will on you.
Yeah, that's an easy observation for a new student to make, is they feel like, yeah, they're getting beat up, but, I'm also new here and maybe some athletic problems with what I'm able to do. But you look around and the people who are good at it aren't particularly breathing that hard. They, mm-hmm. look like they just kind of been jogging for a little while. It's not not much really going on. And the newer students are laying there exhausted, contemplating calling an ambulance, nothing that bad. But, it's just just a night and day difference. And, yes, they're doing things differently, and you're going to get there eventually. But continuing to work so hard all the time as far as using your strength and your attributes like that may not always be the best thing when you're starting out.
Right. I think, I've had over the years, a variety of different kinds of students, and one of my observations is that for me as a trainer, as a coach, it's always been easier for me to take somebody who's, a little more passive and slower and methodical and turn them into, a quality grappler, versus somebody who's, we used to use the word spaz, somebody who's spazzing out. We actually, my son coined a new phrase. He says glitching. He says when they're glitching out. But when they come in and they're very aggressive and very, it's in their nature to be aggressive and strength dependent. It's harder to, I found it's harder to slow somebody down than it is to speed them up in that case, it's easier to take somebody who's calm and teach them quality jiu-jitsu and then teach them aggression later on. So,
well, that's an interesting concept. I haven't really thought about having the different poles there to one's going too fast, one's going too slow, and which one is easier to actually fix that.
Right.
Larry, you mentioned that you kind of just fell into the role of having students and coaching. You know, your instructor kind of headed out of town, and, you know, you decided that you wanted to continue to train, so you were providing mat space, and as that grew, you ended up really fitting into this role. Could you tell us maybe a little bit more about that situation and what that was like, going from just one of the training partner, you know, people that happen to have the mat space, to really stepping up and being the main coach and the owner of the gym?
Well, I think, you know, there are a couple of things there. Like, one was, I'll backtrack a little bit. I met my wife at the dojo at the college. I was assistant instructor at the time, and she actually enrolled in the class a couple of weeks late. And I was assigned the task of catching her up with the rest of the students. And so that's how we became acquainted. And she's originally from Russia. And so that summer she went back home to Russia, and didn't really know if I was ever going to hear from her again or whatnot. And she came back the following fall, and we actually got reconnected and started dating. And then a few months later we're engaged, and then a year later we were married. And that was 2002. That was the same year that we opened up the dojo. And she was a major driving force behind that as well, because I was kind of a talker, saying, yeah, I'd like to do this and we would like to do that. And she was the one that was getting on the internet and looking up, you know, prices on mats and figuring out how we were going to buy the mats and find a space and do all that. And she really got the ball rolling. And at that time, she was a judo brown belt herself. And so we got a small place, you know, in a downtown area, upstairs from a China shop of all things. and so that was a major part of it, you know. But the other point was that a reality set in with us too, where, you know, when I was helping run the judo program at the college took care of all the business end of things. You know, there was no business knowledge that was needed. You just showed up, you taught class, and you left. And so when we first opened our place up, we thought, well, heck, you know, we put our name on the door and put some mats on the floor, and people are just going to be, you know, lining up to come in and train with us. And that wasn't the case. And so we had to learn about the business end of things. And that took a while. You know, I'd already been a lifelong martial artist, but so I felt I, you know, was confident in that area, but the business end of it was a totally new thing for us. So that was a growth process in itself, figuring out how to run the business end of things.
Larry, do you remember when it started to maybe turn the corner and start to become easier to run the business side?
Yeah, we went through a few, you know, consulting companies, you know, kind of like, you know, but they mostly dealt with karate schools. And so we had to modify a lot of things that they were doing, you know, and you know, like, you know, the belt ranking systems and that type of thing. You know, Kodokan Judo and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, you don't get your black belt in just a couple of years. It doesn't happen that way. And so we had to modify some of our programs to kind of fit our belt ranking system and that type of thing. And that started to gradually work more and more and more. About 3 years ago, we moved to a location that seems to be a really, you know, blessing to us. We moved right across the street from the local Boys and Girls Club, and we have nine elementary and middle school, high school in our area, and all of those schools have a school bus drop off at the Boys and Girls Club, which is across the street from us. We have a good relationship with the Boys and Girls Club. I do summer camps, bully prevention camps with them every summer. And so we developed a pickup system where kids can be dropped off at their club and we can walk across the street, pick up the kids that train with us, I mean, and bring them over to the dojo, and they get to train with us. And then when they're done, we can take them back over and check them back into the Boys and Girls Club, and their parents can pick them up there later. And that the location has helped quite a bit. And we have a larger facility now. We have a 6,000 square foot facility. We have about 2,500 square feet of matting in there right now. And we're working on adding some more actually. But I think that really helped our kids program quite a bit, being across the street from a high traffic area for parents and kids, and then being able to see, you know, what we were doing. And we did, you know, the summer camps and those types of things that we were doing helped parents see the value in what we were doing. And so that really sparked the interest.
That's an interesting use of your location. I don't know if you planned that or if it just happened, but could you maybe describe what your summer camps are like that you teach there?
Well, they're usually about a week long camp, and they're what we call a half day camp. So about 3 hours, which at first was a challenge. You know, how do you occupy kids for three hours, you know, and keep them busy and keep them happy. So we had to learn some games and a lot of things, you know, to do with the kids to keep them occupied and having fun, you know, because that's one of the biggest things with teaching the kids, especially, is that it has to be fun. If it's not fun, then they're going to lose interest in it real fast. And so what we do with the kids is we spend time through the week teaching them about bully prevention, with how to deal with bullies verbally, how to deal, you know, with the different categories of bullying, you know, and then also how to deal with bullies on a physical level, as far as you know, what's allowed in their school systems and that type of thing. Because, you know, back in the old days, we were taught, you know, block, punch. You know, that was kind of the system for dealing with bullies. You block, punch, and kick. And schools in our area have what they call a zero tolerance rule, meaning that, you know, if two kids get in a fight, regardless of who started the fight, both kids will be suspended from school. And so we've kind of borrowed something from the Gracie bullyproof system. We borrowed a few, you know, just a kind of modeled our system a little bit after theirs with some of the things that they do. And so one of the things that we teach that I learned from that program was the control and negotiate. And so what we teach the kids is, you know, how to, if it does become physical, how to deal with the bully without punching or kicking the bully and protecting themselves from being punched and kicked. And then how to verbally address that situation when they actually end up in the principal's office, you know, hey, this is, you know, I took these steps to keep from, you know, to prevent this bully from hassling me. And it continued and finally escalated to where it became physical. And I took steps to protect myself and make sure I didn't get hurt, but I also took steps to make sure the bully didn't get hurt. And so, and kind of a main point that we make with the kids is that their family is going to back them up if they, you know, if they get into those types of situations. We want them to be able to go to their parents and let them know that they're being bullied and, you know, who to communicate with. And so, you know, we tell them, hey, we're not guaranteeing that you're not going to get suspended from school if this happens, but I am going to let you know that I'm not going to be mad at you, and your parents are not going to be mad at you if you took the right steps and then it still got to this point. So that's part of what we run through the bully camp, with those types of ideas, and then send a lot of information and literature home with the kids for their parents to read. And then we usually do a end of the week graduation with the kids where we will have them demonstrate some of the techniques that we've been working on for their parents, and then present them with a white belt and a certificate, and that kind of lets them earn their white belt. And those are primarily kids that don't normally train with us, and so it also creates a nice doorway for them to enter into our dojo and become, you know, students here as well.
Yeah, you get them. I guess you get them hooked in that, and yeah, show them that it has some pretty good benefits even while they're at school. Not all bullying is necessarily physical. How do you right. What advice? We always hear about how not to get, you know, beat up on the playground and this sort of thing, but sometimes just kids are relentless with picking on each other and really could ruin you know, someone's day, week, or semester. You know, just mm-hmm. being ruthlessly mean to somebody. How do you recommend that kids deal with that sort of thing?
Well, there's a few different things, you know. A buddy system is good, you know, so we tell the kids how to use the buddy system, so that if they, and it doesn't mean that they, as a buddy, come up and you know, attack a bully who was picking on their friend. It means that, you know, maybe they're going to come up and grab their friend by the shoulder and say, hey, let's go do something else, and just kind of pull their friend away from the situation and just kind of show the bully that, you know, there's some backup here. This kid has a friend, you know, who's going to back him up. So buddy system is good, you know. And also just another thing that we borrowed from the bulletproof system is the talk, tell, tackle. And that's kind of an important piece of it, because kids often don't know, they're told to tell somebody, but they don't know who to tell, you know? And so one of the things that we teach them is the right people to tell in a situation like that, especially at school. You know, they need to tell their teacher, they need to tell the principal, and they need to tell their parents. And then I tell them, you know, if you're a student here, you need to tell me too, you know, because if I hear that you're just getting into fights at school, it's not going to bode well with me. But if I know that you're taking the right steps and that you're dealing with the bully situation, then I'm going to back you up. You know, I'll even go to your school and talk to the appropriate people about it. But, you know, so we teach them the talk, tell, tackle, and then, you know, talk to the bully first is telling the bully that they don't like what they're doing and they want them to stop. So it's kind of giving them an idea of, especially with the younger kids, you know, I explain to them sometimes that maybe their friend doesn't even realize that they're being a bully. And I explain it to, you know, and we're talking about 5-6-year-olds kids, little kids. And I'll explain to them that, you know, hey, if your buddy hits you on the shoulder, you know, and it's just something he does, and you ask him to stop and he doesn't stop, then he's not really as good of a friend as you think he is. He's being a bully to you. And that's when we're going to address it further, you know. But if you ask him to stop and he does, then maybe he actually is your buddy and he just didn't realize that he was, you know, hurting you. And the same thing verbally, you know, if somebody's saying something that, you know, you can respond to it. And then if they continue with it, then that's a bully situation, you know. And there's a difference between conflict resolution and bully prevention. You know, conflict resolution is just, you know, people don't always get along. And sometimes, you know, kids will argue with other kids. And it doesn't necessarily mean it's a bully situation. It means that they just don't see eye to eye about something in particular. If it's an ongoing thing and there's an imbalance of power and you know, other traits of bullying, then that's what defines bullying. Then the kids need to deal with it.
Yeah, it sounds like a great program you have going there. You kind of teamed up with the Boys and Girls Club. How did you approach them? Did you just walk in and talk to them and see if they were open for this sort of idea, or how'd you get that ball rolling?
Well, actually, they have a summer camp program that they do that includes numerous different sports. And so kids can register to do lacrosse, or they can register to do volleyball camp and that kind of thing. And so it goes on for a week at their facility. And they actually approached me, how many years? 5 or 6 years ago. And we jumped on it with, yeah, of course we want to do that. That'd be great. And so it was that's actually part of how we found our location. Was we were someplace else. We were up the road a ways, and driving in one morning for a summer camp, I thought, man, this there's a lot of buildings around here that would be nice to, it'd be a good place to run a dojo. And, coming out from one of the days of camp, I look across the street and there's a big for rent sign on the building. Okay, we've got to check that out. And so the next thing we know, we're moving into the place. But their camp has been going on for a long time. And now we've been part of it for probably, like I said, maybe about 6 years. And the last 2 years, it's actually been, they had to put a cap on it because there's been the interest in it with the kids has increased so much, so that they had to actually put it on a cap on it and say, well, look, we can only let 40 kids do this time. So, which is, it's fun, you know, to know that we're competing with the other sports that are in that summer camp, and we're at the top of the heap right now.
Are most of the kids wanting to sign up for this because they're like currently victims of bullies, or that it's just a fun activity for them to do, and picking up these skills is just an added benefit?
I think it's mostly because they want to do something fun and different. And I think their parents are part of the influence in that too. So I think sometimes maybe their parents are wanting them to, you know, maybe learn a little bit of martial arts, learn a little bit about self-defense, and then kind of, it's a good way for them to test it out and see, you know, kick the tires a little bit and see if it's something they want to continue with their kids.
But Larry, I'm interested in hearing your thoughts about the zero tolerance policy towards fighting. Let me make sure I'm on the same page with that means. If little Larry and little Byron are both in like fifth grade, and I go up there and I punch you right in the face, we both, no matter what, get suspended, or we both get the same trouble. Is that the way it is over there?
That's pretty accurate.
And so how, if you go to the school to talk with the administration about one of your students that happened to have a little bit of trouble, what's the conversation like?
Well, if the kid has taken the right steps, you know, if they've talked to their teacher, they've talked to their principal, they've talked to their parent, they've talked to me, then that's a sign that there's a problem, that there's been a problem, and that these adults should be they're in the loop. They know that there's an ongoing problem. And so that's one of the things that I would typically address is, you know, obviously this has been going on for a while. If I know about it and, you know, you as the principal know about it, then it's been going on for a while, and it's not just some isolated incident. This is something that's been an ongoing problem. That's one piece of the approach to it, you know, and the other piece is, you know, that I can't really change their rules as far as their zero tolerance rule. And it was done originally as a method of bully prevention, but the way I view it is it's kind of like having laws. Law-abiding citizens are going to obey the laws, but criminals are not. You know, they've made the choice to be a criminal, and in a bully situation, the bully is not really influenced so much by that zero tolerance rule. The good kid, the victim, is the one that doesn't want to get suspended from school. You know, and so they're less likely to defend themselves because they're afraid of the fact that they're going to get suspended from school. And that enables the bully to at least verbally harass the kid even more because there's no fear of retaliation. And so that's, you know, I've talked to the school superintendent, and he really likes our bully prevention programs. But that's kind of just a rule that's already been kind of set in stone, and we're working with them, and we're trying to see if we can make some changes happen. But I really don't foresee them taking away that rule at any point in time, because, you know, it has reduced bullying by a small percentage, but I just don't think it does a good enough job.
Yeah. Own opinion on this one. It's a pretty lazy way to try to figure out what happened during these situations. We'll just punish both of the kids equally and move on. And a lot of good kids who end up in kind of a tough spot end up getting the punishment that really affects them negatively, and they get seen as a bad kid now by their others, you know, by their peers, and they kind of, I don't know, it could do some actual damage on their image as well.
Yes, yeah, I agree. And you know, just their self image and self worth too, you know, and just the fear, you know, that's an added fear. They're afraid of the bully, and then they're also afraid of the consequences of being suspended from school, you know. And like I said, that's one of the things that we really try to communicate with the kids is, hey, you know, your parents are concerned about your safety more than anything else, you know. And if somebody is attacking you and you don't defend yourself because you're afraid you're going to get in trouble at home, that's an incorrect way of thinking. Your parents want you to defend yourself. Your parents want you to protect yourself. They don't want you to go out and pick fights and get into trouble. But if somebody's trying to harm you, and they can't be there to protect you, they want you to be able to protect yourself.
Yeah, that's well said. Larry, you mentioned that you have a lot of kids in your actual school, not just the going there and teaching the summer classes. What are some of the goals you have for your students that are children?
Well, we teach jiu-jitsu and judo, but we really like to consider ourselves kind of a higher education system. You know, we are teaching leadership skills. We're teaching kids things that we think will help them later on in life as far as career goals and life goals. You know, so there's literature that we supply our kids with. There's and recommend to them leadership material. We do a monthly homework with our kids that are enrolled in our leadership program that gives them a video module that they watch, and then they do a homework sheet on it, and they get stripes on their belt for that, which they love. They love getting stripes on their belts as an award for bringing in homework for us. So we do a lot of different things that are not just physically jiu-jitsu based. We do a lot of things to promote their self-growth and develop them into the future leaders. You know, that's kind of one of the main goals for us. We like them being able to, you know, protect themselves physically. We like for them to develop the confidence that comes with jiu-jitsu training. But we think that really carries over to life skills and not just the physical part of it.
And how do you explain that to parents that are interested in getting their kids enrolled but don't really know if it's any different than the soccer program or, you know, having the kid play tennis in the afternoons?
Yeah, that's kind of a tough one sometimes, because I think parents really see jiu-jitsu as a recreational thing, as a sport that's, you know, like most sports are seasonal. So a lot of times we'll get a question, well, how long will they do this, this martial arts thing, you know? And me being a lifelong martial artist, my answer is, you know, for the rest of their life, you know, this is not just a one-time thing. This is something that if they want to, they could continue to do it forever, you know? So that's a tough one to get a hurdle to get through with the parents sometimes as far as that. But, you know, the main thing educating the parent on the value of the program and versus the price sometimes too. You know, they have to see the value in it, that it's going to improve how their kid behaves at home, how their kid behaves at school, the confidence that their child is going to have in those places, and then the physical things too, as far as the balance, coordination, and ability to defend yourself. You know, all those things kind of add to it, and really, it's just about conversation with the parent is usually about educating them on the value of the program and what their child is really going to get out of it, not just a fun activity for a couple months. It's going to be a lifelong thing that's going to affect them.
Yeah, we could definitely hope that. And if they do enjoy it, there's no reason why they ever really need to step off of the mat and stop training. And that I can see parents not really understand that, because most sports have seasons, you know, like, okay, it's wrestling season, mm-hmm. it's football season. And then they do that for the few months and then it's on to the next thing, or, you know, yep. it's nothing at all sometimes. But with this just seems to be pretty constant. And I think that some parents don't really understand that type of commitment. They don't understand why it doesn't have a little defined stopping point necessarily.
Right. Well, and our biggest competition, you know, isn't the karate school down the road or, you know, anything like that. It's actually, you know, soccer programs and, you know, volleyball programs and those types of things. Those activities are actually, you know, as far as us, that's the challenge that we have to overcome as far as getting kids enrolled and sticking with this is competing with those programs.
Yeah. And you're likely competing with, to keep the kids there, you're likely competing with a parent that also did soccer when they were younger, and they want their kid to have the same great experience that they had. There's not that jiu-jitsu background that they had as a child now that they want to share with their kids. So a little bit tougher on that as well, but that's definitely a hurdle that can be overcome.
Yes. Another thing that we get is, you know, after kids have enrolled, and this is something that I think isn't a topic that isn't touched on quite enough, is that, you know, everybody, regardless of your age, when you're doing martial arts for any length of time, you're going to plateau. And when you plateau, if you're aware of what's going on, you know, myself, I've been doing this for a long time, and I tell people, you know, I actually get excited when I hit a plateau, because I know that once I get through the plateau, I'm going to have some kind of breakthrough and it's going to be really cool, you know. But kids don't have that same mindset. When they have a plateau and things aren't as exciting as it was, you know, in the first couple months that they were training, they want to move on to something else. You know, we want to do something else. And parents, I have conversations with parents about this all the time. I say, you know, your child doesn't realize that they're going through a plateau and they're going to have a breakthrough and something, you know, really cool is going to happen for them. That's going to make it to where everything works really awesome again. But us as parents, we need to be able to communicate that with the kids and keep them training, you know. One of the things that I say very often is that kids don't quit jiu-jitsu, parents do. You know, parents are the decision makers, and they're the ones that want to keep their kids, you know, that should keep their kids enrolled and not let, you know, a six-year-old child come and make the decision, hey, I don't want to do this anymore. I want to do something else. You know, we don't want the kid to hate it. We don't want to push them into it so much that they hate it, but we do want them to see the benefits and the results of it, you know. So oftentimes I'll encourage them to at least keep your child enrolled until the next promotion, you know. And when they get their new belt or their new stripe on their belt or whatever, they're going to be excited about that. And we'll see, you know, if they want to move on or if they want to, you know, if they want to continue training or if they want to, you know, if they really do not like it and want to do something else. So I think that's kind of a tough part too, is teaching parents how to deal with teaching their kids about the plateaus that we all go through and how to break through those things.
Do you recommend that kids compete in jiu-jitsu?
We have kids that compete. It's something that I don't push. It's something that if they want to compete, I want to coach them and make sure that they're doing the best that they possibly can and getting the results that they want, you know. But our main thing is, our motto is a quote from Jigoro Kano, and that it's not better to be, or it's not important to be better than somebody else, but it's better to, but better than yesterday. And so, even when I'm doing rank promotions or things like that, I talk to the kids, I talk even the adults, I tell them, look, this is not because you're any better than anybody else that's below your rank in this room. This is due to the fact that you're better than the person you were yesterday. You know, if you're a white belt getting a gray belt as a kid, you know, that you're the gray belt who could beat the white belt kid that you were yesterday. It has nothing to do with anybody else in the room, you know? And so it's more about self-growth than it is about competing with others. And I think that competition for them, the way that we approach it, is it's a good testing ground for them. If they have it in them, if they want to compete, you know, we want them to do well, but it's also a learning process for them. You know, if they go and they compete and they come back, you know, I never really discuss much about winning and losing. We talk about, you know, did you learn and did you have fun? You know, those are the main things, because especially at that age, you know, I think the pressure of winning and losing can be too much for them. And just, it's supposed to be a learning experience. When you go and compete, it's still a learning experience. You're going to test your skills and see what holes there are in your game that you can come back and develop those things.
Just from your, experience and what you've seen in the past, would you predict that kids that compete stick around in jiu-jitsu longer, or maybe they're just more interested in it so they compete, or do they compete and then quit after the competition? Or what's kind of the, does competing help kids keep training?
Boy, that's a tough one. I don't really see much of a difference as far as that goes. I think I think a lot of it has to do with the mindset of the kids and of the parents. You know, sometimes if the parents are putting a lot of pressure on the kids, then that can, you know, that can work against them. I think that what we do here is we try to develop kids into leadership roles. And I think that helps with the longevity of keeping them training is the, you know, we take them from a beginner student to a fundamental student to an advanced student to into an instructor, you know, assistant instructor type position. We have what we call a storm team. It's a special team of role models. And these kids come in and they help lead warm-ups for the other kids' classes, and they get to do some extra things inside and outside the dojo that you know, are kind of preparing them to be assistant instructors. So we're kind of building our bench strength too for future instructors as well. But I think that helps them see some goals that they would like to achieve, you know, within the program. And so it makes it to where they want to stay longer. And eventually, you know, after so many years, you're just hooked. You can't get away from this stuff after you've been doing it for a while.
Larry, I'm curious about your teaching method with the kids. Are they all in the same class, or are there multiple levels of kids' classes? And what kind of techniques are they learning as far as jiu-jitsu goes?
We have multiple levels. There's our essentials class is a 4-6-year-old class. And that's a class where we use something called transfer teaching. So, and this has been, it's a pretty amazing how the kids respond to this. And I actually use this transfer teaching method in all of our classes. But in our essentials class, that's exclusively how we do it. And what it means is that the coaches, the trainers, we do the techniques with the kids. And so a lot of times they don't know necessarily what a guard is or what a mount is or a side mount or, you know, those things. We put them in the positions and we guide them through the movements, you know, so that they're getting it 100% correct every time they do it, because we're putting them in the proper position. And then we do a few reps with them with that, and we're developing their muscle memory, you know, while we're doing that. And eventually what happens with those kids is when they graduate up into the next class, which is kind of a beginner class for 7-12-year-olds, we call it our fundamentals class. When they get to that class, they continue doing pretty much the same curriculum, but they're now doing it with partners their own size and age. And by then we're in that class, really what we're developing is their ability to be a good training partner, you know, and listening and following directions and being able to drill, you know, being able to go do drills and that type of thing. And then once they've got that nailed in pretty good, then they move up into our advanced classes, which are split up. We have a 6-8-year-old program and a 9-12-year-old program. And we only split those up mostly because of, there was a lot of them. So we had to break it up a little bit, but then also because, you know, there's a big size difference between a 6-year-old and a 12-year-old. Sometimes it's just, you know, the 12-year-old, I've had 12-year-olds that were, you know, 185 pounds. So like, okay, well, he's not going to work with the 40-pound 6-year-old. So that's, you know, so we had to separate them up like that too. And then once the kids get to 13, they bump up into our teen and adult class, and we have the teens and adults in one class in the evening. So, and we're here 6 days a week. We have classes Monday through Friday, and then we have a, you know, morning, early afternoon class on Saturdays. And that seems to work pretty well for everybody.
It sounds like it's going good over there.
Can I add absolutely. Something to that about the kids program? Okay. And, you know, with our advanced kids, you know, part of what determines whether they, you know, when they make it into the advanced class is their ability to partner up, you know, with a good practice partner, not just somebody who they can goof around with, you know, and be silly with, but, you know, be able to find a partner that they can get the work done with, you know, and hustle through the drills. And, you know, if they're able to do that, then they get to move up into the advanced class. Once they move into the advanced class, they actually get to do more drills because they're able to get through it faster. And then they actually get in a lot more grappling rounds, you know, so they get to do rounds of grappling at the end of class, and which is, you know, super valuable for their development. But you can't grapple if you don't have grappling tools, you know, so they have to go through that fundamental stage first to develop, you know, some basic skill sets before they get to move up and then actually get to roll with other kids and, you know, spend time doing that.
Are there some techniques that you really focus on teaching or some that you don't teach at all to the kids?
We try to make the focus, especially for the fundamentals kids, to be just about position, positional control, you know. So if you're on the bottom, they learn a couple of basic sweeps. They learn how to maintain, you know, top control positions. They learn how to do some basic guard passing and a couple of basic takedowns. But not really focused on submissions at all in that class. When they move into the advanced class and they've got a good handle on positional control and that type of things, then we start working on some basic submissions, you know, like a basic arm bar, basic Americana, those types of things. And their temperament has to be right too. That's another qualifier for getting into that class, is if they've got, you know, if they're overly aggressive and can, you know, hurt another kid, we're going to wait a while before we put them in there and let them get a little bit more control and self-discipline before we bump them into there. We're always very careful with the kids as far as communicating with them, you know, that this technique could potentially cause an injury if you misuse it, you know. And so we make sure that they're, mature enough to understand, you know, those things before we start teaching them submissions.
We've talked a lot about jiu-jitsu and kids and benefits that it provides. How about with adults? What are your adults getting out of jiu-jitsu and the class and being part of the team?
Well, we really, you know, I really like to emphasize a family atmosphere. You know, I think that I joke around, but it's a joke but not a joke. I talk about how studies have shown that, you know, if a 22 second hug releases the oxytocin hormone, which is a bonding hormone, and I tell them, hey, we're hugging each other all the time in here, you know, we're it's sometimes a violent hug, but we're still hugging each other. So you're very close proximity, you know, with the people that you're working with. You're sweating on each other, you're smashing each other, you're sitting on each other, you know, and those types of things. And so you develop a different relationship than you would, you know. Like I know when I did striking arts, I didn't develop any kind of relationship with people like that. You know, your space bubble was way bigger. You know, it's super, super common. And you know, this in the jiu-jitsu community, to see people hugging each other at the end of practice, it's reasonable. Everybody does it, you know, and that's because we're just so close to each other when we're on the mat. And so I think that's part of what helps develop those relationships, is just the, you know, you're physically close to somebody, and you're helping each other develop, you know, and we're learning to be comfortable being uncomfortable. And we're, you know, I really like to stress a team atmosphere too, to where, you know, a mutual benefit. So if, you know, if I'm training with somebody and they, you know, catch me with some technique, you know, and then that's cool. They catch me with it again. Okay, that's cool. You catch me with it a third time, you know, hey, maybe you should tell me what I'm doing wrong and help me fix it, you know? And if I fix it, then, you know, I'm going to improve. And if I improve and you can't catch me with that thing anymore, you're going to improve too, you know? And so people are, you know, climbing the ladder together. And I really emphasize that mentality to our students here. And so everybody is, it's built a pretty good culture over the years to where everybody's very helpful. We use a mentoring system also. So when we have a new student coming in, I partner them with one of our more advanced people, you know, who's, you know, not just going to smash them and beat them up, but who's going to educate them as we go through the process. You know, if I'm teaching some drills, it's kind of, you've got the personal tutor right there helping you, you know. And then of course the advanced student benefits from teaching as well, because they're helping the new student learn, you know. And so we kind of had to, educate some people on that, because not necessarily in the early days did an advanced person want to work with a beginner. You know, they didn't necessarily want to do that. They felt like they were being held back. But once people realize that they're learning by teaching, you know, they're learning greater detail by helping somebody else, then that it really took off after that. And everybody here is always happy to help new people when they come in and help each other. Even if you've been here for a long time, if you're struggling with a technique, you know, you're going to find somebody in the room that's going to help you with it.
Yeah, the learning by teaching idea often surprises me. I could do a technique. I could feel like I really know it very well. When somebody asks me to show it and I have to kind of break it down and try to learn it from their perspective, oftentimes things I realize that I really didn't think about or have to even worry about, because that's how I'm doing this. And they might find a little roadblock, like, it's not working. What am I doing wrong? Well, I guess I'm also doing this. I didn't explain that to you at all, because I always do that, you know, this particular way. And right. And so it's really right. A way that to really learn about some techniques or some things we do on the mat a deeper level with somebody who's not as skilled as you.
Right. I always say I learned more from teaching than I ever did from doing. And that's because, you know, especially if you're the head instructor, you have, you know, a large number of students and they're all going to learn in their own different ways. And so you have to approach it several different ways and, you know, teaching one technique, one person might grasp it right away. Another person might be, you know, a more audio person who, you know, who needs to hear you explain it. Another person might need to feel it, you know? So those are things that I learned, you know, over the years by the trial and error, you know. But I think that definitely teaching helps you learn things in a much greater depth than just, you know, just practicing it.
Absolutely. And that's a skill that you'll pick up a little later on. You know, if you're brand new, you're probably not going to be teaching very much jiu-jitsu. But as you get a little bit better, you'll get paired up with somebody who needs your advice. And that's something that is part of your growing and development as well. Larry, what would be a good goal for a student during their first year of training?
I think a good goal, you mean like a new beginner student?
Yeah.
I think a good goal would be to develop a sense of confidence that comes with jiu-jitsu, that at first, you know, it's for those of us that have been doing it for a while. And this is something, another thing that I'd like to mention is that, you know, as instructors, we forget what it's like to be brand new to this stuff sometimes. And you kind of take things for granted, you know, when the how uncomfortable it is for somebody when they first walk through the door to do what we do. You know, even I watch parents sometimes who are, you know, less involved, and they'll watch a class and you can see them cringe because they're just not comfortable with the idea of somebody laying on top of somebody or sitting on them or smashing them, or, you know, and seeing that kind of a struggle is pretty foreign to people. I think that's something that as instructors we have to remember and help people get past that point of that discomfort that is in the beginning for a lot of people. And that's something that, you know, I think as a new student, that's kind of their goal, or should be their goal, is to learn to not be afraid of this and learn to process and problem solve. And I think that will help them in everyday life as well, you know, because if you have somebody who's trying to arm lock you or trying to choke you or do something like that, and you can't just not deal with it. You have to solve that problem. And if you don't, then, you know, you're going to have to tap out or pass out or something. But I think it's a very important thing for people to learn how to be comfortable being uncomfortable and learn how to problem solve. And it doesn't mean that they're going to get that overnight. It's a, you know, it's a process, of course, but I think that it's a gradual thing. And sometimes students don't always even realize that they're having those successes. I explain that to them frequently, you know, hey, I'm standing up here and I'm watching you, and you're doing stuff that you was totally foreign to you, you know, 6 weeks ago. You would have no idea what the heck that was. And now you're able to perform it. not necessarily flawlessly, but you're doing it. You understand what it is, you know, the mechanics of it. And I think just getting comfortable with that whole situation and tying that in with your everyday life is I think a big thing for people to do that they don't necessarily see in the beginning when they first come in.
Yeah. And that's a good point that you made, that we forget about that. After you've been doing this for a while, you forget how hard that was at the beginning to overcome that uncomfortableness.
Right. I had a guy recently come in, a teenager, and I met with him twice. He came in just to, you know, schedule a time to come in and train, and so we scheduled it. And then when he actually showed up to train, the guy he was physically shaking. He was so nervous about getting on the mat. And it reminded me, you know, because for us, it's so natural. We just come in and we do our thing. You know, we don't think about it. And I'm looking at him and he shook my hand. His palms were cold and sweaty, you know, and I realized this guy's having a panic attack right now because he's so worried about getting on the mat, you know? And so I told him, I said, look, guy, you're not, this isn't Fight Club. You know, you don't have to fight. you're going to come here. We're going to show you some techniques, you know, and you're going to drill some stuff with some people and it's going to be fun. You know, it's not, nobody in there is going to attack you and try to beat you up. This is going to be a fun day for you, you know? And I talked him down and calmed him down a little bit. And then of course he had a great time. So, but it was a reminder to me, like, oh man, you know, this is his first day here and he's kind of freaking out.
Yeah. You really have no idea what's going on in their head about what's stressing them as far as concerns for their own safety. What am I getting into? You know, yeah, is this Fight Club? You know, definitely not. We want you to break the first two rules of Fight Club and talk about jiu-jitsu and bring other people in as well. So
that's right. That's right.
Larry, I'm interested in you as an early martial arts, as an early jiu-jitsu person. What were you like as a blue belt? Kind of take me back to that time and describe yourself as a blue belt for me.
Well, it's kind of I guess a unique situation. You know, when I started doing judo at the college, it was 1990, and that was just a few years before UFC made its big debut. And then a few years later when that happened, a lot of us would stay after class and grapple, you know, besides just the stand-up, you know, judo throws and that type of thing. My instructor was pretty educated on the groundwork, too. But being a typical, you know, Japanese judo guy, he wanted the focus to be in the stand-up. So he really didn't teach us a whole lot of that stuff until we got to about a brown belt level in judo. And then we would work on our groundwork. But I had a lot of friends that would come and we would train after class. We would stay in the mat room and we'd just grapple for, you know, a couple of hours at a time. And so that was kind of our introduction to jiu-jitsu. There weren't really jiu-jitsu instructors around back then. They were hard to find in our area. If you wanted to go, you know, train under anybody who had any type of rank, you had to travel quite a ways. And some of those friends that were rolling with me back then were students at karate schools, taekwondo schools, tangsudo schools, that type of thing. And so, back then, the jiu-jitsu tournaments were these little sideshow things at these karate tournaments. And my karate friends would let me know, hey, there's going to be a jiu-jitsu tournament. And you'd go and there'd be anywhere from 8 to 20 people there to compete. You know, it wasn't a huge thing. And they'd have a big karate tournament going on and you'd have a little, you know, 16 by 16 mat area off in a corner someplace in the gymnasium. And here's your jiu-jitsu tournament. And oftentimes you know, there are no weight classes, no rank classes. People showed up and you guys are just going to roll, you know, you're going to figure it out. Or maybe they would kind of eyeball us and decide, okay, well, these guys are the lightweight guys. These guys are the middleweight guys. These guys are the heavyweight guys, and go do your thing. And so, so that's kind of what it was like in the early days, but I wasn't even ranked in jiu-jitsu. I was just a judo guy. And I watched the rules change. You know, there was each tournament had its own set of rules. There was no really set rules for things as far as the scoring system and that kind of thing. But, you know, eventually you know, jiu-jitsu really, really took off, and there started to become some more quality instructors around. And when we opened our dojo in 2002, I still wasn't affiliated with IBJJF or anything like that, any kind of particular instructor. You know, I'd been to some Tim Cartmell seminars and some Hoyter Gracie seminars and some other seminars, you know, and done that thing, but not really been ranked in jiu-jitsu. And that didn't happen actually up until about 3 years ago when we became an affiliate with Impact Jiu-Jitsu. And that partially happened because we really wanted to ramp up our jiu-jitsu program, but I wasn't ranked under any particular professor. I'd just been training, you know, and doing judo and doing grappling. And we had, you know, quite a few students that were competing regularly in jiu-jitsu and submission wrestling tournaments and that type of thing, but weren't really, you know, IBJJF ranked or anything like that. And so we aligned with Impact Jiu-Jitsu and Michael Chapman. And so, from the outside perspective, it might look as though I had transitioned through some ranks rather quickly, going from, you know, from 2013 to now and being a brown belt right now. But from the inside, reality is that, you know, I've been doing this stuff for, you know, a couple of decades and learning it and practicing it and going to different places and learning it and practicing it and drilling it. So I went from a white belt to a brown belt, I guess what could be considered quickly, but really because I've already been doing it for a long, long time. You know, I just recently came out of, I guess, retirement to compete, and I competed at the SJJIF World Championships down in Long Beach, and I got a second place in my division, but it sparked my interest again to where I enjoyed it, and I really want to compete some more. So that's my plan for this year. And my 2017 goal is to get in some more competition. I'm 47 years old, so I like to get it, you know, while I can.
Yeah, that's cool. That's I could understand your story of not having really a formal rank or anything, and then suddenly, you know, you've been training for a long time, and it's like, okay, we got to get this guy, you know, a more accurate ranking. So and then taking that and going competing with it, that's really cool. Mm-hmm.
Well, we wanted to be able to rank our students and you know, and have them legitimately ranked in jiu-jitsu. And so that was a big part of it. And, you know, I've been friends with the guys up at Impact Jiu-Jitsu for a long, long time. You know, Michael Chapman, Armand DeBruge, Brian Marogue, and Matt Leach, you know, those guys run the schools up there. And I've been friends with Matt Leach since high school, and he was actually one of my judo students at the college years ago, and then moved away and continued to study jiu-jitsu, and eventually, you know, got to his black belt, and he's a first degree black belt right now. And he was my main contact up there, and he said, "Hey, you know what? I know you want to get this ranking system, you know, all locked up, and so this is something that we can definitely help you with. You know, we have the right guys to make that happen." And so, so that's kind of where all that kind of unfolded. And Chapman is a black belt under Chris Howder. So this is, you know, I'm pretty, happy with that lineage as well.
Yeah. That is pretty cool. Larry, where could somebody find you training if they want to get some mat time with you or, get a hold of you?
Well, we're in Roseburg, Roseburg, Oregon, and we have a website. It's roseburgdojo.com. And, you know, there's information on there, contact information, that type of thing. We're open, like I said, 6 days a week. Our adult evening classes are, you know, we do that Monday through Friday. Friday is our kind of our open mat day. We call it randori, but it's open mat where we come in and we grapple. We spend, you know, hour and a half, 2 hours just getting in rounds of grappling and troubleshooting and that type of thing. But We're also on, have a YouTube channel. It's Dynamic Martial Arts Roseburg. We post videos on there of basic techniques, nothing super fancy, just some basic techniques that are part of our curriculum for, white to blue belt students mostly. So, basic scissor sweeps and that type of thing, nothing super duper fancy. Every once in a while, we'll do something cool just for fun, but it's mostly basics. And then, of course, on Facebook, we're on social media. So if you look up, I think, Dynamic Martial Arts Roseburg on Facebook, that's another good way to find us.
Awesome. I'll put links to those in the show notes for people to find. I appreciate you talking with us today. Do you have any final words for the grapple out there listening to what you have to say?
If you haven't tried jiu-jitsu, you should. I think that it's, I have a biased opinion. I think it's for everybody, but, and that's arguable, of course, but I think that, something I would like to emphasize also is that it's not just for guys, we do a women's self-defense program, and we do women's self-defense seminars pretty regularly. And I think that for self-defense, jiu-jitsu is one of the, is in my opinion, the most practical art for self-defense. And so I think that people sometimes get caught up in the sport aspect of it and forget that there's a self-defense, element to it as well. And so I think that for women and for kids in particular, I think it's a really good thing for them to learn. I think also a conversation that I've had a lot here lately, we have kids that train with us because their parents have brought them in, and the parents are saying, I don't know, numerous times I've had this conversations where the parent tells me, I did martial arts when I was a kid, and I really wish I would have stuck with it. And you never hear somebody say, my parents, made me stick with this, and I really regret that I got my black belt. That doesn't happen. It's something that it takes time. But I think that if you have a kid and you're wanting to get your kid interested in it, you should. If you're an adult and maybe you did martial arts in the past and regret stopping it, get started again. I get the question sometimes, am I too old to start this? And I say, you're too old not to. You need to do it. Everybody should do it.
There you go. I love it. I also am a firm believer that everyone can do jiu-jitsu and definitely should at least try it. And you might even like it. It's a fun way to stay in shape, and it brings so many other benefits to your life as well. Larry, it's been a pleasure.
Absolutely.
And I'll be in contact with you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Well, I'd like to thank Larry Keith for taking the time to come on the show. It's just incredible having the guy on, and just the submission, no pun intended, I guess we'd say, the submission for one of his students to be, coach of the year, just shows the type of guy he is. And you could get that from the interview. Just an incredible coach, an incredible person, incredible teammate.
Yep. And he was up against quite a bit of competition as well, because a lot of you guys sit in your coaches. So honored to have him on the show. Really thrilled that he did it. It wasn't a requirement for him getting coach of the year, but asking if he'd like to talk about jiu-jitsu and what he's doing over there, and glad that he was willing to do that and get to see what he's doing there and really helping his community and his students a lot, and definitely a person to look up to as a coach and as a jiu-jitsu practitioner. So great having him on the show.
Yeah, definitely. Hey, speaking of the show, check out BJJ Brick on social media. We're not just on Facebook. You can catch us on Twitter, catch us on YouTube. Our YouTube channel is actually blowing up, not physically, but more and more people are checking it out. So check us out on YouTube. We're also on Reddit and a couple other social media outlets. So, and also tell your friends about it. Let them know about our YouTube channel, and hopefully y'all like it.
All right, Gary, time again for the Referee's Corner. So here we go. Now it is time for the Referee Corner with David Silver Fox Karchmer. The Silver Fox is a BJJ black belt that has refereed over 3,000 matches, gi and no gi, kids and adult, from white belt to black. And now he answers your questions. David, what would you do if you're refereeing a competition and somebody is obviously sandbagging?
Well, that's a tough question to answer because sandbagging itself is hard to define. Some competitions have actually made it a priority where they actually would keep track of competitors' a competition record to make sure that, you know, they're literally were called anti-sandbagging records. So for those competitions that maybe that don't do that, or there's so many, you know, it's hard to say, and it kind of breaks out into, you know, two considerations as well. It's a little easier to see a blue belt and what a blue belt is doing because he's in his gi and he's wearing his blue belt. But when people move around in no gi, you really don't know what belt they might be or what divisions that they're entering, and it could be a little more challenging. As far as the referee's obligation, it's kind of not a part of the referee's role to have an impact, usually in bracketing in general, or certainly knowledge of individual competitors and where they may fit. That's really something that rests on the tournament organization. But hey, there are times when you see somebody in a division and they're steamrolling all their competition, and you say to yourself, hey, come on. Personally, the only thing I'll do is I would ask the competitor, like, hey, how long have you been a blue belt? And I may say to the coach, give the coach an elbow and be like, wow, looks like he's ready for, you know, a purple belt. So more like friendly suggestions or kind of a wink, wink, nudge, nudge that your competitor maybe is not in the appropriate division. Something I'll add to that's sometimes hard to know is, let's say that somebody's a 10-year judo competitor and a black belt. But guess what? They just started Brazilian jiu-jitsu and they've only been training for a year and they're a blue belt. When you start seeing them tossing people around, you think to yourself, wow, this guy is way, you know, outclassing his competition. But then you'll see other parts of his game that maybe are less sophisticated. So, you know, it's hard with so much cross training to really put an accurate finger on it. But again, I don't think the referee's obligation is to do something specific about it.
It sounds like it's more the organization. Some of them will focus more on trying to make the matches as fair as possible by keeping records. And some it's, you know, more of an honor system. And if you're saying you're this belt, or you say you've been training this long, compete in that division. We're trying to kind of a sportsmanship type of a attitude.
I'd say it's mostly, it's mostly an honor system, much, you know, which is inherent in martial arts. It's inherent in belt promotions. You know, it should definitely be an honor system. And the only thing that sticks out, I think, most obviously, is if, you know, the same blue belt is coming to the same tournament and he's winning the same division tournament after tournament. You know, somebody has to raise a question like, hey, you know, is it time for a belt promotion or do we want this person in this division? So it's hard to identify sometimes. It's unfortunate if it does happen, but I don't think it's a huge part of the game.
I think some people get frustrated sometimes with somebody, say you won blue belt division, you get bumped up to purple, you know, during purple belt competition, like 2 weeks later, you also win that. Now, there's no obligation to make you a brown belt right away just because you won that purple belt. You've been a purple belt for 2 weeks. You just happen to be really picking it up very well and competing well. Kind of that area where I'm going to spend my time as a purple belt. I'm going to probably win a lot of tournaments. And sure, it's going to be rough for everybody else around me, but I don't need to become a brown belt within a few weeks or even a year after getting my purple belt. It's just do you have anything to say about that?
Yeah, two things actually come to mind. One is that, there are some people very early on in their jiu-jitsu journey that develop a set of skills or a particular game that is super effective, particularly against people their level. And they can use it almost like a formula to finish people off rather quickly, whether it be in their own school or it be in competition. Where you see the weakness or the chinks in the armor, and I'll use blue belt as the category very often associated with sandbagging, you know, that transition from white to blue and blue to purple, is that you'll see somebody that when they're moved outside their game, you'll suddenly see that their other skills are not at the same level. And when you see that, then you go, oh, okay, I see why he may not be the next belt level yet. He's got a lot of work to do in these other areas. So that comes to mind as one scenario. Another one that's very common is when you see someone working in a no-gi advanced division and they are just super competitive, or maybe they win no-gi advanced. And then you see it's the time for the gi part of the competition and you see them put on a white or a blue belt and you're like, wait a second. So, you know, we have to understand and accept that a lot of schools these days can be no gi focused, and these guys don't train in the gi. They don't get promoted with belts in the gi. A lot of the Brazilian jiu-jitsu community gets furious when people get promoted. You know, we've heard some famous MMA fighters or famous grapplers getting promoted to black belt that have never competed or worn the gi. So you can't have it both ways. You know, if the guy's never been promoted as a gi player, then he's wearing the belt that he was last given, and it just doesn't always seem to fit. So these are a lot of the complicated issues that fall into sandbagging. But in general, I'll mention sandbagging comes in as an excuse a lot of times for competitors, much like referees, biases or favoritism or, you know, bad reffing. It becomes like the dotted line for competitors on why they failed, why they did not succeed or win competition. It was because of, you know, the other guy not being in the appropriate division. So we have to watch and make sure that people are not using that as a crutch.
This has been the Referee Corner with David Silver Fox Karchmer. If you have a question for the Referee Corner, send it to bjjbrick@gmail.com. And of course, go to thegrapplingreferee.com for great articles, videos, and podcast interviews by David Silver Fox Karchmer. If you have a question for the Referee's Corner, send it to bjjbrick@gmail.com, and we'll pass it along to David Karchmer and keep this going with all these fun questions. We've got a few more in the queue, and we'll do them every few weeks. So thanks again to David for that.
Thank you, David.
If you want to support the podcast, you could do what Gary just recommended. Tell your friend about it. That means a ton to us. If you want to support us financially, we have an account on a website called Patreon. There's details to that in the show notes. Basically, you would donate a certain amount per show, and it would chart. Let's say you want to donate $1 per show. At the end of the month, it will look how many shows we did for, and then it will charge your card $4. And that would go towards helping the show and keeping this brick floating. So it's pretty simple. There's different little rewards we have set up at each level. So check it out. There's a little video on there you can check out and really kind of get explained to you what's going on there. So Patreon's been a lot of help. We have definitely some of our biggest fans on there supporting the show on Patreon, and that really means a lot to us. And if you are on Patreon and supporting us and you're not in the Facebook private group, send me a message because I definitely want you in there. I know most of them are, but some people I can't find on Facebook, and I know not everybody has Facebook, but it's a place occasionally I'll go. I'll say, hey, I'm interviewing this person today. You know, what do you guys want me to ask? And get a little bit of information. Occasionally I'll ask, you know, a question. I'll say, hey, so-and-so wants me to ask this question. And that's usually from the private group. And I'll throw up, like, I had some t-shirt designs I was working on and kind of throw those up there to get opinions from you guys. And that's just a place we can go there and have fun. And also on the private group, we were making fun of Gary pretty hard. I was photoshopping little fun, you know, hairstyles and stuff on him the other day, so that was kind of a good time. It was a few weeks ago, a few months ago, but yeah, good times on the private group, and we get that through Patreon.
Yep, good times at the expense of me, yeah, you always, big bully.
Always the best way to do it. Hey, speaking of good times, at the expense of our friend Gary. Here we go, my friend.
Yeah, I led you down that path.
Thank you for the easy layup. Didn't even pull my hammy on that one.
Another one.
Burn. Yeah. That was below the, below the belt. Below the belt. I'm actually on the hamstring.
Next show at 8, 2 drink minimum.
Don't forget to tip your waitresses and bartender. Gary, you have an audiobook coming out. You know, we've got the first year in BJJ, and also we have the BJJ Brick Fun Pack. It has all the mat tales and some of the highlights of the world's most interesting grappler in there. But we're trying to get Gary to make an audiobook. But each week that he does this, he has no idea what the audiobook is called. So he's got to kind of make up an outline for it on the spot, tell us a little bit about the audiobook. Gary, this week you're working on a book called Ghosts and Other Odd Happenings on the Mat: My Experiences with the Paranormal While Grappling. So, Gary, what is going on there? You've got a lot going as far as experience on the mat. I didn't know you had this as well. And this is kind of scary, spooky.
Yeah, you know, the problem is I told you earlier, you know, I am being chased all the time. That was kind of one of the big reasons I left New York and came out here to the Midwest is ghosts and the paranormal. You know, one of my favorite shows is Poltergeist. Another one of my favorite movies is The Ring. I also like to watch The Flintstones. That has nothing to do with anything, but I just thought I'd throw that in there. So, you know, this audiobook is, you know, going to talk about the best way to use jiu-jitsu to take care of the paranormal. And I've used it over and over again, and I've made all the mistakes. And most of you people have probably never had to use jiu-jitsu against a ghost, so you don't know the different techniques that's going to work. And so that's what I'm here to do. I'm here to basically cut out all the fluff. We're going to go right to the meat and potatoes. If you're a vegetarian, it'll still work, so don't worry about that. But it's, you know, it's just going to show you the moves that don't work. Like, tell me, Byron, okay, I know you've never been, you know, been attacked, you know, or had to, you know, throw down with a ghost. Tell me, do you think a Kimura would work well?
I'm not even sure that a ghost has shoulders.
Well, see, that's what I was going to tell you. Kimuras, arm bars, they don't work. I've never seen shoulders. I've never seen an arm on a ghost. So, I mean, those moves do not work. So you cannot use them. I mean, so there's not a lot of moves you can do. A lot of it is, you know, moves like bear hugs. And, you know, because the good thing is they can't get out of it because they don't have arms to, you know, open that bear hug open. So, you know, you can hold them there for, you know, hours in a bear hug. They won't move, and pretty soon they'll just get tired and quit. And that's normally what I found works best, you know, just an everyday bear hug. And I guarantee you do that to any ghost, they're used to scaring people. They're like bullies. Most people won't fight a ghost. Ghosts are really horrible at fighting. They're just used to scaring everybody, and nobody steps up to them. So if you step up to them, you put a bear hug on the ghost, it's over. You may have to stay in there for about 4 or 5 hours till the ghost, you know, finally gets his spirit, no pun intended, broken. And, you know, once that does happen, it's over. They won't mess with you again. And the thing about ghosts, they all know each other. They will tell other ghosts, and they will just leave you alone and go mess with your good buddy. So you won't have to worry about it. So definitely check it out. It's actually going to be for free, you know, when this book comes out. I really just want to help people who have problems with the paranormal.
Yeah, I think maybe a subtitle will be Breaking Spirits instead of Elbows. Or shoulder,
yeah.
Or something like that.
I like that. Yeah, I'm going to use that. Yep.
Put that in the book. Gary, I've learned from you two techniques, definitely not moves, but maybe just a technique or a strategy that you could use on ghosts. The first one is your classic, you know, what's that over there? And when the ghost turns to look, then
you attack.
In jiu-jitsu, you attack. In this situation, maybe you just take off running. I don't know depends if you have his shoes on or not.
And no, you never want to run from the ghost. They can fly. They don't get tired.
They float. Don't even have to flight, you know, wings or nothing. They just go.
Yeah. So, no, you don't want to do that. When they're not looking, though, it's a lot easier to get them in a bear hug. And then, you know, I guess one thing I didn't mention, though, remember how I told you're probably going to have to bear hug them for 4 or 5 hours? What I do is I get like a 70-pound Everlast punching bag. And I will just put my arms around it, and I'll start out like 10 minutes. Because, I mean, it's not easy to work up to 4 hours of bear hugging something. And I work my way up, and what I try to do is 4 sets of 5 hours. So, like, if I'm going to do bear hugs for a day, I need 20 hours. And I'll do 4 hours, take a minute rest, do another 4 hours, take a minute rest, 4 hours, minute rest, and my last 4 hours. And that way, you'll get good at being able to hold a bear or hold a ghost for, 40 minutes to 4 hours.
It seems like the bear hug is a key fundamental to this type of attacker, and which kind of leads me to the second technique that I've seen you use with a lot of success in jiu-jitsu, and you can also switch it over to the ghost, is to distract them with idle conversation or a few jokes, and then sneak in there for that bear hug as they're talking or thinking about the joke or laughing about the joke. And you, boom, you're in there and you're on it.
Yeah, yep. You know, another one I like to use that really gets the, you know, the ghost not thinking about what's going on in front of them. When they're not looking, I take a bag filled with dog poop and I light it on fire and I put it right in front of them. And while they're stomping it out, that's when I attack. So that works really well.
For years, I've wondered why you carry that bag around with you everywhere you go. And now I know.
Yep. And you just thought I was huffing paint.
I just thought you liked dog poop. I really didn't have a good theory. But now it all makes sense. And that's one less weird thing that I have to figure out about you.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the book is going to be great. We're looking forward to it coming out. And we'll be having more details about it very, very soon, I'm sure. Gary and I are both located in Wichita, Kansas, which is kind of in the middle of the United States. If you're traveling through, like our friend Mark the other day from Florida, hit us up with an email, bjjbrick@gmail.com, or message us on our Facebook page, and we'll be happy to try to get on the mat with you and have some good time. So if you want to like to travel while you train, or train while you travel, and or do both.
Some people like to train, and what about traveling and training while on the train?
That could be done. That would be pretty epic.
You could put a mat in a train.
Yeah, and you could bring a drill and start drilling. Something on train.
Good point. Good point.
Oh, Gary, I think we're losing it, my friend. Maybe this will be the last podcast we ever do because we lost it so bad. Or maybe next week we have Josh Hinger on the podcast, my friend. Noki World Champion 2016.
I think we're all going to be Hinger Team next week.
Well, that's going to be great. So catch us next week. As always, stay sweaty, my friends.
And don't forget to shower.
Thank you for listening. I hope you find the time today to roll. After all, the best way to get better at Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is to do Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu.